Well, good morning. Welcome to Trinity Baptist Temple. Thank you so much for being here this morning. I want to read a scripture in Psalm 98. It says, "Sing unto the Lord a new song, for he hath done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm hath gotten him the victory." Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. Lord, we know that, God, you have the victory. You've already defeated Satan, the grave, through your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord, and we thank you so much for that. Lord, we thank you for the fact that you have that strong arm, Lord. As you go on and you read in the scripture there, it says that you know the heathen, you know what they do. You have your judgment for them as well. Lord, I pray, if there's anybody here this morning that doesn't know Jesus Christ, Lord, that they wouldn't leave this place without placing their faith in him and him alone. Lord, bless this service in a mighty way. Bless the singing, the preaching, everything that's said and done. I pray that we bring great honor and glory to your name. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you will stand with us this morning as we sing.
Your faithfulness, O God. the Lord this morning. Lift your
Once again, welcome to Trinity Baptist Temple. Thank you so much for being here this morning. If you're a guest, a visitor, first-time visitor, we consider you our honored guest. If you need anything, see one of these guys in the gray jackets or right out front. There's a welcome center, so I'll be out there to answer any questions you might have, meet any needs you might have. And if you're a first-time visitor, don't forget, after the service, stop by that welcome center. We have a gift for you that we'd like to give you. Just say welcome and thank you for coming, choosing to worship with us today. Let's pray and ask the Lord's blessing on this offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you once again in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you so much. Lord, how great God you are, Lord. The God, the one and only God, the creator of everything that we see, Lord, in this universe. Lord, our hope and prayer is that all will see how great you are. But we know there's a lot of work to be done, a lot of souls to be reached. Lord, I pray that you would use this offering, that many, many, many might see how great you are, how powerful you are, how you can transform lives. They can hold broke down, wretched sinners. Lord, and transform them. Something new and glorious. Lord, then people would experience the power of salvation through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, use this offering in a great and mighty way. Bless the remainder of this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Was a life filled with aimless desperation, without hope, walk the shell of a man. Then a hand with a nail print stretched downward, just one touch, then a new life began, and the old rugged cross made the difference. I will praise him forever and ever for the cross made the difference for me. Echoed harshness
Praise the Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Will everyone please stand? Sing with us down at the cross.
Down at the cross where my Savior died. Down where for cleansing for sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory. Glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. To my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
Years I have spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary.
grace was free. Pardon that was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I'd spurned. Till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy that was great and grace was free. Pardon that was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. All the love that renovations planned. All the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Mercy that was great and grace was free. Pardon that was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary.
Praise God.
I'm waiting on you, Lord, and it is painful. But patiently I will wait. I will move ahead, bold and confident, taking every step in obedience.
Amen. Praise the Lord. It's good to see y'all here this morning. Y'all happy to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. You have your Bibles, turn over to 2 Kings, sorry. Cross-reference there. 2 Kings chapter 12. As you're doing that, I just want to again extend a welcome to all of our guests. If you're a first-time guest with us, thank you so much for being here. We don't take it lightly that you came here. And so please, if you have any questions, anything we can pray with you about or serve you with, please let us know. We made it back from camp, from junior camp. Praise the Lord. Man, crazy. No, the kids had an awesome time. It rained a little bit up there, but they had a great time. And I said it before, I say it again, I'm so thankful for our children's ministry workers and our counselors. Just so thankful for their love and their heart for kids, because you know you got to have a heart for kids when you have been there and have experienced the stink. It's nasty. And to hear Brother Jesse, bless his heart, he came back and they unloaded everything, and he came up to me, and he was about to leave, and he said, "I'm sorry, brother. That van is horrible. It reeks. I don't know what's wrong with it." Go to find out that some of the boys hadn't taken showers all week. One, maybe two showers, wet clothes, nastiness. Oh, my goodness. We got a solution for that, but they might not like that. But it was a good time. We had a young man get saved from our group. And amen. Praise God. I praise God for that, because each year, especially when you bring in kids that may not go to church regularly, or families aren't bringing them to church, and for them to be able to go to junior camp and unplug and focus on the Lord and hear the Word of God and hear the gospel presented several times and going to church and memorizing scriptures and then for them to get saved is just an amazing, amazing thing. Brother Jason was talking to me after he had made the decision, and he said, I don't know how to explain it, but something's different in me. Something's different. And Jason was just with tears, like, man, that's an amazing testimony. And he said, that's the Holy Spirit. And he goes, even if I start thinking it's weird. And he goes, that is a good sign. If you start thinking wrong, you think to do something and you feel a little conviction, it's a good sign that something's been changed in your life. But this morning, we want to get back into our study. Last week, I covered 10 practical applications that we could use. I gave those to you. And what those were to ensure that what's necessary as Christians in our life would get accomplished, whether it's at the job, whether it's in our home, in our neighborhood, wherever it is. We had 10 practical applications, and somebody asked that list after service, said, I didn't have a pen, I didn't write those down, can I get that? And so I printed that off. If you would like that, then I can get those to you as well. Say, how was that used? Keep it in your desk, put it in your work truck, put it in your car as you're going to work, and just to remind you, see the scriptures there, see that some of those reminders, put it in your workout bag. And whatever the case may be, get that list if you didn't take it down, and always just keep it before you to have a conscious and deliberate effort. So, you know what? I'm going to be light. I'm going to make sure that I'm doing what's necessary for the kingdom of God on a daily basis. But this week, we're going to see another sad relenting, another sad giving away, surrender of what is God, what's special to God's, and giving it away to the enemy. The Bible says that there are several things that are precious, and I'm gonna just cover a few of those things before we get into the study. And I'll put this list up on the screen so you can follow along with me, and you can do a little personal Bible study and see some of these things in Scripture, or I can give you several different references to these things. But these are things that Scripture says are precious. And so one of the first things is this: there's certain stones that the Bible says are precious. There are stones that are considered to God. Of course, it's his creation, but in general as precious. There's also, number two, certain metals, such as gold or silver, that are considered precious metals. Again, this is found in Scripture. Number three is land and elements of land. There is land that is precious, and again, part of the elements of land. Number four, blood is precious. Again, Scripture tells us that blood is precious. The death of God's saints is precious in his sight. Another thing that's precious according to Scripture is seed. And we understand that is both precious to the agricultural world, because seed is necessary for there to be produce and food and stuff, so it is precious. But we know there's a bigger implication spiritually, that seed, being the Word of God, is precious. The Bible says that seed is precious. The seventh thing is this, ointment. There's precious ointment that the Bible speaks of. Number eight, God's thoughts towards his children are precious. Number nine, wisdom and understanding, according to Scripture, are precious. And they're to be more desired than any of those elements in this world, the Bible says. And then the tenth thing is this, man, according to Scripture, is precious to God. And so, a few weeks back on Wednesday nights, I was going through a psalm, Psalm chapter 49, and we talked about our redemption being precious. We've seen that there are several things, again, in this list that are precious to God, and I believe because they're precious to God, because Scripture says they're precious, especially when we're talking about the spiritual things, the things that are of God and God desires, they should be precious to us. We should consider these things precious. And so with the thought of us covering Psalms 49 a couple Wednesday nights a little while back, I'm not gonna cover that, but I want to look at that Scripture because I want to think about the idea of our redemption being precious in God's sight. In Psalm chapter 49, you don't have to turn there. It's going to be on the screen. You can keep your Bibles at 2 Kings for right now. But it says this, wherefore should I fear in the days of evil, when the iniquity of my heel shall compass me about? They that trust in their wealth and boast themselves in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother, nor give to God a ransom for him. Verse 8, for the redemption of their soul is precious, and it ceaseth forever, that he should still live forever and not see corruption. See, I believe that you and I, again, as I covered when we were going through that, we should view this as precious and then handle our redemption accordingly. Again, if we're thinking about things that are important to God should be important to us. We've seen that in our study on Sunday mornings. We've seen that through the kings. They didn't make what was important to God important to them. In the same regard, what God says is precious, we should hold as precious and handle it accordingly. I don't know about you, but growing up with three boys, there was a hard, or growing up in a house where there was three boys, it was hard for my mom to keep precious things in the house. Things were being broken, lamps, lights, stuff. One time I was on top of a chest of drawers and pulled it over on top of me. You couldn't have precious things around a house of three boys. They just get broken. But the things that are precious to God, we should hold as precious and valuable. And that should be evident in our life. Scripture also tells us in 2 Peter, you don't have to turn there as well to be on the screen. You can if you want to, but 2 Peter chapter 1, the first four verses says this, Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like, listen to this, precious faith. We didn't cover that on the list, but this is another precious redemption, precious faith. With us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power hath given, listen to this, unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that called us to glory and virtue. Now listen to verse 4. Whereby are given unto us exceeding and great precious promises. The grace, the virtue, the mercy that God has poured out to us, the fact that we have the knowledge of Jesus Christ, a relationship with him through that precious faith that we've placed in him, God has extended to us exceeding great and precious promises. That song that the choir sang a while ago, I love that song. The old rugged cross made the difference. One of the verses in it talked about there's a scene, and there's darkness and gloom, and it's the sadness that goes over someone who doesn't have hope of eternal life, the loss of a loved one, and it's dark and it's gloomy. But the song said, but at the sight of a saint, there's rejoicing. There's hope. That's a promise of eternal life. It's a precious promise given to us in God's word by God himself to us. And so when we go through this life, this is just an application here. We go through life and you're struggling, you're doubting, you're having some difficult times, going through a valley or whatever the case may be. That's why we sing the song, Count Your Many Blessings. You can recall the promises and the blessings that God has given in our life, and joy and hope can start springing up in your heart sometimes, even in the darkest of times. But these great and precious promises are exceeding, the Bible says, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. That's an amazing thing. God, through the promises, through his faithfulness, has given us these promises, and we can hold to them and know that we're not going to see any corruption, we're not going to see any destruction or judgment because of our sins. Again, that's a great promise of God. So this morning, I want to consider again what's precious to God and how it should be precious to us. We'll see that in our scripture. Let's pray. Father, we come before you. We thank you for allowing us to be in your house again. Thank you so much for the cross, Lord. The theme that we saw in the music service this morning, so clear. Lord, that is such an amazing display of your love and grace. Lord, another example of a promise that you made, that you kept, and that you have kept. Or that you shed your blood. You made a way where there was no way that man had, Lord. You provided the path for us to have a relationship, a restored relationship with you as mankind. And we thank you for your promises. We thank you for the things that you reveal to us that are precious. And God, this morning, as we look into your word, I pray our hearts would be open to your word, that we would be listening to your spirit as you proclaim and you declare what we need this morning. God, we know that we're in a desperate state as a nation, but God, I'm not ready to give up. I'm not ready to sit back and watch. Lord, I want to make sure that myself and this church, God, that this body is healthy and is thriving and is running the race with patience, Lord, that we are striving together for the faith of the gospel. Lord, that we're fighting the good fight of faith. Lord, that we're not looking to the things and the circumstances surrounding us, Lord, but we're looking to you, the author and finisher of our faith. Lord, that we are standing firm on your promises, and again, living this life to the very end for your glory. Lord, this morning I pray that you would have your way. Just use me as a vessel. We'll praise you for it all, Lord. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, again, I want to talk about keeping the things that are precious to God precious to us. We reiterate this. What's important to God should be important to us. And in a similar way, God says things are precious. I think how I'd maybe divide this is like that. We looked at applications last week. Those are things that we can do, commandments, principles that we can apply in our lives, things that are important to God, and they should be carried out because they're important to us. But there's things that are precious that may not necessarily be a direct action we take, but more maybe of a mindset that controls or directs our actions. So we value what God values, and we esteem what God esteems, and we hold precious and dear what God holds precious and dear. Again, that is vital in our life, and maybe it's vital to keeping important what's important to God. Earthly wisdom, I want to talk about that for just a second, because this is something that I think our world, our nation, even Christianity today is plagued with. A lot of people operating in earthly wisdom. You say, what are you talking about specifically? See, earthly wisdom is manifested by immediate gratification and resolution. A lot of times when give you a good example in relationships, whenever you're having a disagreement and you've reached your end and your patience has run out, and a lot of times you just fire off because in your mind, in your fleshly wisdom, you think, I'll just end it here. I'll speak my mind. I'll finish this. This argument will be over. And earthly wisdom acts for an immediate gratification or immediate resolution. And we know in relationships, when we're talking and we act in earthly wisdom, typically it costs more than what one is willing to give in the long run. Typically, when we say what our mouth or what our mind thinks in that moment, in the moment of passion and frustration and seeking immediate gratification or immediate resolution, most of the time, that's going to cost us, going to affect us more than we really want to give. And it's not really true wisdom. It's foolishness to God. The Bible says that. But earthly wisdom is manifested like that. But heavenly wisdom, operating in the wisdom that descends from above, operating in wisdom that comes from God, seeks lasting solutions and peace. And sometimes heavenly wisdom, godly wisdom, means that we have to wait. We have to be quiet. We have to be still. We have to be patient. We have to take on things that may cost us something up front that we want, but will pay dividends in the long run. And the same thing, you can apply it in relationships. Most of the time, if you just wait and hold your mouth and or hold your actions or and just, okay, God, direct me, help me, then most of the time it'll cost you not being able to speak or act the way you want to right then, but it'll pay off in the long run. That's wisdom. That's heavenly wisdom. There's a bit that the Christian comedian Tim Hawkins does. Don't do this. But he said that they teach you in marriage seminars conflict resolution tools. And he said that one of the things they do is to tell you to ask questions. In the moment of an argument, in the heat of the craziness of the argument, he says, ask a question to diffuse the situation. And so he gave an example of him doing that with his wife one time. We were heated. We were arguing. Passions, tensions were high. And in the heat of it, I stopped her. And I said, honey, why are you being a psycho right now? He said it after he came to a couple minutes later. Pulled the butter knife out of his shoulder. That type of waiting and that's not heavenly wisdom either. Just so don't do that. But there's a difference between earthly wisdom and heavenly wisdom. But in our study, the reason I say that is we've watched kings from both the north and the south, but we're looking at the southern kingdom right now, the kingdom of Judah. Follow the same pattern. And we've seen this king that's currently on the throne in Judah do right in the sight of God, the Bible says, but he did not remove the high places. Again, it was the standard set. It was what all the kings before him in the south had done. They had let one thing keep them from what was best. He was experiencing the goodness, but he was not experiencing the best. Again, we talked about that. We preached about that even in our own lives. When we do that, though, this creates a spiritual temperature. It creates an example. And for the king of the south now, it's providing an example for an entire nation. A leadership principle that's vital that I want to bring out this morning where we talk about this is this. People do what people see. People do what people see. Again, the southern king has set the spiritual temperature. He has set the spiritual example. And now the nation has followed the same path, settling for what's good and not experiencing the best of what God has. Operating in earthly wisdom and not operating in godly wisdom. Again, this has been the path that they've been taking. The nation has followed. People do what people see. Ever hear a kid say something crazy or embarrassing? Anybody got a testimony? No. You hear a kid say something out in public or something at the store. Lord have mercy. Sometimes they say, and the question that comes out of our mouth when they say something or they hear something, most of the time, what's the question when a kid says something that's kind of outlandish or out of the ordinary, or what in the world? What is the question that typically comes out of our mouth when that kid was that? Where did you hear that? That's right. Isn't that interesting? Something out of the ordinary, not right. They say something. They're acting a certain way. Well, where in the world did they hear that? Where did they get that from? The truth is this. They probably did hear that somewhere. They probably did get that from somewhere. The same way you see a kid acting crazy, doing something crazy out loud. You say, man, what are they doing? Why are they acting like that? Where did they get that from? From mom? Oh, no. From dad. But this should help us remember. We see examples like that, or we recognize and we admit to that truth that when kids do that, our first question is where they get. This should help us remember that leadership is influence. Even in the home. Hey, listen, parents. On the regular days, normal house is going the way it's going. What you do, what you say, not just that, but how you do it and how you say it is influencing your kids. It's influencing. Leadership is influence. And guess what? It's like we talked about last week. The same thing in the office or at work. That's why the first thing on the list was don't be the pessimist in the office. Don't be the pessimist in your family get-togethers. Don't be the one that's always critical and always negative-minded and having that sour attitude around people. Don't be that person. Be the child of God that's supposed to be light, full of joy and hope and peace, gentleness, kindness, meekness, love, patience, self-control, all those things. Be that person who God has called us to be. But again, at the job, the same thing. People are watching and you're influenced. They say, I don't have any influence at my job. I got all kinds of bosses over me. I'm the lowest on the totem pole. I promise you, you're influencing someone. Everybody has an influence on somebody. In some form or fashion. A study that was done by a research firm years ago said that 89%, did you hear that? 89, almost 90% of what we learn is visual. Comes from a visual place. 89%. 90% of what you and I learn, we learn it because we see it. We've seen it. It's in our eyes. Then they found that 10% comes from hearing, the things we hear. As you do that math, it can be tricky. 89 plus 10 is 99% of what we learn comes from what we see mainly, and then secondly, from what we hear. So only a small fraction, a little 1%, comes from other senses. Like, ow, that's hot. 99% what we see and what we hear. You know what that tells me? That research firm probably interviewed thousands of people. They probably did all kinds of different diagnostic tests. They did all kinds of things to come up with the best figures they could have to present this research to the public and say, we have discovered, or we have found, or I would say more accurately, we have verified what Jesus said thousands of years ago. Hey, I could have saved them all the heartache. Guess what? Jesus already said it. Jesus said, there's a way that comes into your life that affects you. And I want you to see that. It's on the screen this morning. Matthew chapter 6, verse 22. Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount said this, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, if it's healthy, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thy eye be evil, if it's bad, the whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? The light of the body is the eye. What the window into our life, the window into our heart, into our mind, is the eye, Jesus said. If you're putting the junk in, that's what's affecting your life. If you're having the negative, that's what's affecting your life. You've heard it before, junk in, junk out. What you watch, what you hear, junk in, junk out. I used to teach this to the youth a ton when I was a youth pastor. Over and over and over, I would hammer it because I would see the influence in their life. They're so influenceable at that time. The things that were coming out in the movie theaters and the music that was out there, I would bring it up to them all the time. Someone would get, why are you always talking about this? Why? Well, if it's not an issue, it doesn't bother you. Why are you always? You can argue with me all you want, but you can't argue with God and be right. And it's hard to argue with a valid research from a very high standard research company that says 89% of what we learn comes from what we see, and almost everything else from what we hear. 99%. So I said, I can watch whatever I want to watch. Yep. And it'll affect you. That's what will affect your life. So I'll listen to whatever I want to listen to. I don't want to go out and do all those things. You may not want to go out and do all those things, but it's influencing you. And you're learning it. And it's affecting you. It's doing something in you that you may not be, that you may not see manifested right now, but it's doing something to you. The king had set an example. The majority of the nation had followed him because of the example that he set. The things that he was doing, the things that he was not doing, the things that he was saying, the things that he was not saying, the things that were important to God that he was not holding important to him, the things that were precious to God that he was not holding precious to him. It had rubbed off in the entire nation, and the entire nation was set on this spiritual temperature, was set on this standard. Do most things right. Don't worry about the little bad. I mean, we're not perfect anyways, and all will be okay. That's the wrong spiritual mindset. That's the wrong spiritual temperature. That was the example that was set and the example that was being followed. What should they have done then, Brother Kyle? I mean, are you talking about sinless perfection? No, they should have been striving. Though he were a man, and of course, obviously would fail because he was a man, because he was flesh, nevertheless, he should have been striving to set the example that God had called for. They said a while ago, in the home, what we say, what we do, how we do it, how we say it, all those things affect our kids. You say, you're trying to tell me I'm supposed to be a perfect parent. No, you should be striving to set the godly example that God says. The things we say, the things we do, how we say it and how we do it should all be governed by heavenly wisdom, by godly wisdom. Everything to our spouse, to our kids, to, again, in the workplace, everything. We should be striving to set that type of spiritual temperature, that type of example. But because of this temperature, because of this standard, because of this example, because of the lack of importance and the precious things to the king and the people, it cost them. It cost the nation. 2 Kings chapter 12, see what it cost them. Verse 17, then Hazael, king of Syria, went up and fought against Gath and took it. And Hazael set his face to go up to Jerusalem, taking care of the northern kingdom, wiping it clean. Now he's going to go down to the south where Jerusalem is. And just remember, Elijah had already shown that Hazael was going to be king over Syria, that it was going to be judgment from God because of Israel's disobedience and disregard for what God had already called for. Judgment, again, had already come to the north. They were already wiping out. Jehu was taking care of business, taking those wicked kings of the north out, taking care of Jezebel, all those things had already gone on. God had cut back Israel. Chapter 10 says that God began at that point in time to cut back Israel. Let's see what happens in verse 18. And Jehoash, king of Judah, the south, took all the hallowed things. You hear that? All the hallowed, the precious, priceless, holy, consecrated, special things that Jehoshaphat, listen, and Jehoram, and Ahaziah, his fathers, his ancestry, these things have been passed down. They were precious. They were priceless. They were set apart for God and the house of God. All his fathers, kings of Judah, had dedicated, and his own hallowed things, and all the gold that was found in the treasures of the house of the Lord and in the king's house. Listen to this. And sent it to Hazael, king of Syria, and he went away from Jerusalem. Wow. Unbelievable. That's hard. And this may be like a superficial, a surface thing. Right now we think, what's the big deal? I mean, it's a story in the Bible. No. Put yourself in that situation. Here you are, maybe just a normal Israelite, and you're going to the temple, and these things you know are important to God. They've been set apart. Generations have set these things apart for God, to glorify God. And all of a sudden, with one decision, with one move, the king, the leader of the south, takes everything that has been the heritage of precious and priceless things that have been set apart for God, that are godly, that point to God. He takes in one decision, in earthly wisdom, to get immediate gratification and find an immediate resolution for himself. He takes everything that was precious and priceless and gives it away to the enemy. And then he bails. Nowhere to be found. All of the gold, all of the treasures that were found in the house of the Lord, all of it gone. What was special, what was set apart, what was precious to God, in fear, just gave it away. Not only that, he flees the place that God had ordained, the land that was precious to God, the city that was precious to God, and he flees in fear. And why was this going on? Why did this happen? What was it? Listen, he had left one thing. He'd left one thing. Remember that? He left the high places. He did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, but he did not remove the high places. Man, he was doing good. He just wasn't truly striving after God. He wasn't holding what's important to God important to him, or precious to God precious to him. He was operating in earthly wisdom, seeking gratification and immediate resolution in his life. And again, it created an atmosphere that the commands, the precepts, the standard, the way, the word of God, the things of God are negotiable. And I want to tell you now, for decades in America, there's been an atmosphere, a spiritual attitude and atmosphere that's been promoted by organizations that call themselves churches. And sadly, by some churches that have slipped away, I believe. That you don't have to do everything, that you can do this and still be okay with God, that you can, hey, we're just gonna do church our way. No, there's one way. It's in God's word. It may not be a recipe for some of the certain elements and stuff that we find in Scripture, but there is one way, and it's the Bible way. It's the way that God tells us in his word, the examples that we see set before us in Scripture, how it's supposed to be done. We have this way. But for decades now, again, in America, there's been a spiritual temperature. Well, I may not go to church every service, but I go when I can. Hey, I had church out on the lake. Hey, it was just me and God in the picnic today. You can argue with me all you want. That's not in the Bible. That's an atmosphere. That's a teaching that is permeated from a culture that has said, you know what? We're okay with good, but not best. We'll settle on good and not have best. That's not the way to hold dear to what's God. That's not the way to say, you know what, it's precious to God. What's so precious? The church, the Great Commission, the bride, the body, it's precious. He died for it. He shed his blood. He rose again. He commissioned. He said, this one thing I want you to do until I return, and I'm going to be with you to the very end. It's not about what makes sense to us, what we think or what we like or what other churches are doing or what this person thinks, or this person's been a Christian. They were this and they were that and they were that, and this is what they do, and they don't do this and they don't do that. No. What does the Word of God say? That's our responsibility, is to hold precious what God holds precious. Again, the temperature that is in the spiritual temperature that's in our nation right now is despicable. It's nauseating. It's hard. It's hard to watch any news, to look, sadly, on Facebook. People putting stuff on Facebook that call themselves born-again Christians and not being salt at all or light at all. But again, feeding right into this culture, this callous, complacent culture. And what's precious to God isn't precious. What's the big deal? Again, the nation had this atmosphere. They had this attitude. They had this spiritual temperature that the things of God that are precious to God are negotiable, that you can just give them away and everything's going to be okay. As long as you preserve yourself and you get what you want and you have life the way you want life, it's okay. That's what the king was thinking. All this stuff, hey, if that's going to satisfy, I'm giving away. Everything's precious and set apart for God, give it away. The priest had it for the temple, didn't take care of what they were supposed to. The people had it for the commands of God. Listen, the things of God are not negotiable. No matter what we think, no matter what we try to do, they're non-negotiables. No matter how much we think they are, no matter how much we try to negotiate in our life, the things that are precious to God, they're not negotiable. Again, in America, we've negotiated the things of God with the enemy. You look around and say, what's wrong with our nation? Complacent Christians. Christians that are okay with giving away what's precious to God. Giving away what once was a standard, was the way of the culture in our nation, giving away, not just because that's tradition, but because of what God's word says. And just giving it away. Just giving it away. And now we're here. Whether it be monetary things, whether it be things like insurance or a certain lifestyle, what have you. And it's costing us. It's costing us, and it will cost us ultimately if things aren't repaired and restored. And please hear me. I don't like to be doom and gloom. I'm an optimist. I'm a realist. I like to stand on the promises and have hope and trust and faith in God. I don't like to be negative, but I want to be real. This is the truth. It will ultimately cost you and I as a nation if things don't change. If they're not repaired and restored, if we don't, just like the priest, 23 years, not doing what they should have been done, what was important to God wasn't important to them, the temperature, the attitude, the wisdom they were operating in, it created this across the board, and it was costing them. Hazael taking care of the north, now he set his eyes on Jerusalem. It's coming. Now all the things that were precious to God, given away, it's costing the nation of Israel. It's about to cost them way more than what they ever thought. And again, America is no different. What colors were the White House lit up for Memorial Day? For Memorial Day? See? God bless America. What color were the White House lit up on July 4th? It wasn't. It's interesting. It wasn't. It was not lit up. Joash tried negotiating the things of God, and he ran in fear. Let's see what happens, verse 19. The rest of the acts of Joash and all that he did, are they not written in the book of Chronicles of the kings of Judah? And his servants arose, listen to this, and made a conspiracy and slew Joash in the house of Milo, which goeth down to Selah. For Josachar, the son of Shimeath, which is interesting because she was an Ammonitess. And Jehozabad, the son of Shomer, who was a Moabitess, his servants, those men, smote him and he died, and they buried him with his fathers in the city of David. And Amaziah, his son, reigned in his stead. Not holding the things of God in high regard. not holding them as precious. And it has cost Joash everything, even his life. He's now gone from being the king of God's chosen people, this southern kingdom, and the things that are precious of God from the temple taken out. The things that were precious to the people, gone. And now him as a king, losing his own life by leaving one thing standing in the way. It created an atmosphere. It cultivated that callousness and that complacency, that slothfulness, that bred the departure from the things that God had called for. It facilitated that, and I promise you this, that the atmosphere, the spiritual atmosphere and culture, again, as a standard across the board in America, is experiencing the same thing. A callousness, a slothfulness for the things that God has called for and that are important and precious to God. Think about it. Think about what gets you fired up in your life. And this is a good group of Bible-believing, Bible-desiring Christians. But even for us in our nation, even for us in this room, a lot of times people can get more excited about a sports game, a World Cup, a World Series. A lot of times people can get more geared up and fired up for an activity. It's fishing. It's hunting. We can get, and if we'll be honest, we can get excited about those things. But when we think about God Almighty, Holy God, King of Kings, has enlisted me, we talked about this morning in Sunday school, has enlisted me into his service as an unworthy person and has entrusted me, given me the resources, all things that pertain to life and godliness. He's given me all the things that I need to be his ambassador, and he's called me to be that ambassador. How many people are ready to do that? And there's the line, the fire, the excitement. Hey, we're going to go to the Super Bowl. Hey, we're going to go to the World Series. We're going to, oh my goodness, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. I wonder what the once-in-a-lifetime opportunity would be, sharing that gospel with that person who may not otherwise get that once-in-a-lifetime opportunity if it weren't for somebody saying, God has called me into his kingdom. I'm so unworthy. I am so unworthy. I need his mercy, his grace, and he's given me the opportunity to take the precious gospel, the precious word of God, the seed. And if I go weeping and bear that precious seed, the promises, the precious promises of God, that I will doubtless come again rejoicing, bringing sheaves with me. There's no greater joy and excitement that we should have in this life than to be a part of the kingdom of God, holding precious what God holds precious. But the nation was set up for failure, and the track that we are on is set up for failure. To not hold precious what God holds precious. Motivated, moved by disregard and self, moving in fear, lack of faith. Again, it was manifested in the king, and it was prophetic of what was going to happen to the nation. Destruction after destruction because of disregard after disregard. Because of the negotiating of the things of God that can't be negotiated with or can't be gambled with. But man, God's people still doing it. We're fooling ourselves if we think just getting upset is going to change anything. We're fooling ourselves and we're deceiving ourselves if we think that if we'll just ride it out long enough, it'll go away. Our nation will change. We're fooling ourselves if we think that we can continue to disregard and attempt to negotiate what is precious to God and not face correction or judgment, just like God's chosen people Israel did time and time again. We're foolish to think that way. But here's the optimism in this. Here's the great news in this. You and I sitting here this morning have a choice. We can get it right. We can get our life set right now This morning, we can get it right before it's too late, before we experience the judgment, the correction of God in our lives and in our lives together as a nation. We can do something now. You say, you know what? I am that person, Brother Kyle. I used to be a Christian so on fire for God. You couldn't keep me away from the fellowship of the brethren. You couldn't keep me away from doing something for God. You couldn't keep me from telling people about Christ. He changed my life radically, took me from a horrible sinner to a saint, a child, his child. He set me apart. I used to be so pumped up for God. And now the things of God are not precious to me. The things of God are not important to me. I've tried to negotiate. I've tried to gamble. I've tried to work my life to do what I want to do instead of being his servant and saying, what wilt thou have me to do, Lord? I've been that Christian. I've been that complacent Christian. I've not taken the things of God as important as I should. Haven't held them in high regard. And if truth be told, I've probably given a lot of what's precious to God that he's given to me away to the enemy. Maybe it's the liberty that he's given you. You've negotiated. Well, I think it's okay if Christians do that. I don't think it's that big a deal if I do this or I do that. I know other people. No. Maybe you've negotiated the grace. Well, where sin doth abound, grace doth much more abound, right? I mean, God understands. He knows what he got when he got me. It's not a big deal if I do this. I know other people that have done this sin. Negotiating the grace. Negotiating the blessings. If God gave it to us, he wants us to enjoy it, doesn't he? Negotiating these things for selfish gain or pleasure. Yeah, maybe you've been led to a spiritually slothful place. We have to recognize and change if something's going to change. Not just say, you know what, I agree. I don't like the direction of our nation. I agree. I'm not where I should be. But you know what? Everything's okay, and I do think things will turn around at some point in time. No, not if we don't turn around. Not if we don't recognize and repent. Turn around. I need to get back to when I was fired up for God, when I couldn't wait to fellowship with other Christians, to be together, to worship the King. I couldn't wait to get to work, to pray for an opportunity to share the gospel with somebody. I couldn't wait to serve God. I felt so privileged, so forgiven. I felt so humbled. Everything in my life was precious because I viewed it through the eyes of grace. It's costing us now. But if we keep operating in earthly wisdom that seeks immediate gratification and resolution, it's going to cost us more than what we're willing to give in the end. I don't want to see America go away. I don't want it to continue to slip from what God had raised up because we're not who we're supposed to be. This morning, I want to challenge you. Are you holding what's precious to God precious to you? And if you're here and you've never experienced the grace, the forgiveness, if you've never experienced God wiping away all your sins because of the blood that Jesus shed on the cross, you've never experienced it, getting that free gift of eternal life because he didn't stay in a tomb. He rose again 3 days later. If you've never experienced a new life, a new birth, just as that young man who got saved at camp said, something's different. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed, and behold, all things have become new. If you've never experienced that change, I beg you this morning, come this morning. There's a couple of ministers, and they'll show you out of God's word the good news that you don't have to spend eternity in hell. You don't have to spend eternity in the lake of fire, in judgment, but you can experience that free gift this morning. I beg you to come. Let's pray. Father, we come before you. We thank you for your word, God. We thank you for what's precious, Lord. And just as I've already prayed and admitted to you this week, there's times in my life that I have not held what's precious to you, precious to me. Lord, I haven't lived that way. I haven't thought that way all the time. But as I've already prayed, I pray again before this congregation, Lord, I want to. I'm not okay with just sitting and waiting it out and see what happens in our nation. God, I'm not okay with that. I want to be everything that I can be. And I know that means me just simply yielding and submitting to you. If I have no righteousness of my own, I have no goodness of my own, but if I yield to you, I know that you'll use me however you see fit. And I pray that for every single Christian in this room. Lord, help us be determined to hold valuable what's valuable to you. Lord, that it be manifested in our thoughts and our actions, our words, that it will influence the next generation, that the tide, the direction would be turned because of our recognition and our repentance, even this day. God, just do something. Stir our hearts this morning. I pray that we'd respond in a way that pleases you. We ask and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'll stand as they sing, I want to invite you to the altar this morning. Maybe just simply pray, God, help me to hold precious what's precious to you. I'll let you come this morning. Amen. Well, praise God this morning. I pray that we'll go out of here this morning and say, you know what? I'm going to change. I'm going to hold precious in my life what God holds precious to him. And go out and be salt and be light and maybe see things start turning in our neck of the woods And other churches will respond accordingly. I think the Holy Spirit moves across all the local churches in the same way, especially when His people are calling out for the same thing. And I think there's a lot of prayers going up for our nation, and so hopefully we'll respond in the right way. Again, if you're a visitor this morning, thank you for being here. I want to encourage you to come back tonight. We have baptism, and we're also going to be taking the Lord's Supper. I want to always include this in that. We always cover it when we do it. But so who can take the Lord's Supper? It's those that have been saved, biblically saved, and those who have been scripturally baptized. And we open that up to you. So I want to invite you back, especially our members. And it's a very special time tonight. And I think it's an appropriate message this morning, going into that tonight, remembering what Christ has done for us. And so, again, I pray that you have a great afternoon. Brother Jeffrey, if you'll come and share a couple of announcements and pray. And as he's doing that, he came up and told me a while ago, little Clay Dean has trusted Christ as his Lord and Savior. And he came forward. Amen. He wanted to make it public, and Brother Jeffrey prayed with them, and so I want to ask you guys to pray for him, and awesome, seeing kids, adults saved. So hope you have a great afternoon, and see you this evening.
Once again, if you're a first-time guest, don't forget to stop by the Welcome Center. We have a gift for you, and then, like you said, Lord's Supper tonight, baptism tonight, 5:30, be here, and then Wednesday night, regular service. And then so this coming Saturday, we have outreach, opportunity to come at 9 o'clock, go out and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's pray, and we will be dismissed. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, Lord. I thank you so much for what we've got to experience this morning, Lord. Singing to our Lord and Savior how great you are. Lord, the message that pricked my heart of us here today, Lord. I wanted to hear this great news, Lord, of Clay and his decision to give his life to Jesus Christ and come forward and want to be scripturally baptized, Lord. That's what it's all about. That's why we're here, Lord. That's why you've left us here. See many, many saved, Lord, and I pray that you would continue to do great work through Trinity Baptist Temple. Lord, bless now as we go our separate ways. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.